morning to everyone.
Good morning.
So I appreciate your effort in waking up early in the morning on Saturday and coming to this course.
So this is you could say a beginner level topic.
So beginner to intermediate, not any specific or like you can say the advanced level. So we will discuss and we will try to identify some new things out of it. So brief introduction about myself. So first of all, why Agile? So whenever we go to any historical monument, say Taj Mahal or Red Fort, so what do we appreciate there?
The value.
Beauty.
Architecture.
Very good.
Anything else?
Carving. Any other idea?
Basically the genetic size actually of that. And it is one of the wonders of the world.
Wonder of the world, yes. Right. So, but think about the project management. Since we are project managers. So, what about the project manager? Like, how difficult was that at that point of time, coordinating between thousands of people, right? Because it should not be like that. The architect has the drawing, the blueprint, and distributed it to 5,000 people, and they start building the Red Fort, right? So there might be a proper mode of communication, some method of creating work breakdown structure, method of work assignment, and then review. Right, so these kind of things are there. So we have like history of successful project management, right, using traditional methods that we call waterfall. So, but still we feel there is need for some different methodology. Right, that's why we go to
Agile.
So,
it was time for the harsh punishment. Yeah.
Yes.
Half
time. Half time. Industries and everything. Right. So now we need to discuss like why Agile. Since we are already successful. Red Fort, if you see Red Fort, so it's beautifully structured, very secure, like can accommodate so many people, huge in structure. Right. So, but why Agile? Any thought?
It's more adaptive to the client's need.
Yes, more adaptive to client's need.
It's something very similar which we do pretty much anyways in our day-to-day life. The way we operate. For example, if I started from my work, or from my home to my work, if there is a red signal, what do I do?
Adaptive. Okay, so we are doing step by step. So we cannot plan, okay, I will get 5 green signal and 4 red signal. That's very good example.
Less of planning.
Continuous planning.
Early feedback.
We can say less planning, but some
responding to change.
Some different level. Planning at different level, you can say. Yeah. There is planning is there because we cannot do anything without any plan. Right. Even we cannot go to our office like without any planning. So there should be some planning. There should be some time estimate. Okay, I have my conference call at 9:30 in the morning, so I should be at this particular time. Right. So one of the reason is less visibility. to explain the visibility, let's take an example. So I was just thinking, it was my real time scenario. So say you are at your friend's place in the night having dinner and it's raining outside. So typical Indian scenario, right? So you park your car in the next street, and when rain stopped, you said like, okay, let's go home. So when you came out, so there is no electricity in the street, and after rain there is waterlogged in the street. So you came out, you just you turn on your cell phone light and start walking towards your car. You walk a couple of steps, then you realize there is some waterlogged area, you jumped over it, you walk a couple more steps, you come across one bike that was wrongly parked on the street, you just negotiated with that, and then you realize there is sidewalk on your right, you jump down to that footpath and then bend toward your car. So you get inside your car safely. Perfect. Second scenario, when you came out of your friend's home, so he came up with the big searchlight. So as soon as you stepped in, he just turned on the light. So now entire street is illuminated. So by staying there, you are able to figure out like where to go. You realize, okay, first long jump on the right, and then from the side of a bike, I need to jump onto the footpath. So which scenario is better? Second. So let's discuss third scenario. You have your tiny cell phone light and you start running toward your car. What will happen? Yes, you may fall on the road, you may end up putting your feet on the waterlogged area, or you may collide with a bike parked on the road. Right. So when we discuss these three scenarios, so the third scenario is a scenario of chaos. Here we say the traditional project management is bad. We should not abuse a traditional project manager just because he is following third scenario. When we say traditional project management, waterfall project management, he should follow the second scenario. That means he should think about the visibility and then plan. So in the first scenario, we plan all the risk. So risk is waterlogged area, bike parked on the road, right? So these are risks, and requirement is to get inside our car. So in the first scenario, we plan iteratively. We just start moving, holding our tiny cell phone light in our hand. So we completed the requirement iteratively as well as incrementally. Agreed? And in second scenario, we planned everything. We stayed there for a while. We planned our way. We planned all the risk, right? And completed the requirement. And third scenario is chaos that we should avoid. So that's why we have agile when we have less visibility. So one of the reasons, there are several reasons or several interests. Second, higher risk. When you have higher risk, the chances are there you may miss some of these. Right? Continuous changing requirement. So why customer change the requirement? Any thought on this?
The customer is not sure of the requirements at the first place. So as you try to develop things, he looks at whatever you have developed, and he has some big picture in his mind, and he looks at what you have developed. He gives feedback in terms of his vision also improves in terms of what he's looking at.
Yes.
Market is also changing continuously. So maybe there is some competitor in the market who has developed a similar kind of product. So you have to change according to the market. So in that case, you need continuous changing.
Yes, very good, sir. So most of the time, customer knows what they need right now, but don't know what will be their requirement 2 years down the line. Right? So even if they have given you sign off with stamp on the requirement document that we have written, so chances are there they will change the requirement based on their understanding, based on competitors' analysis, or based on any legal or any other regulation changes, right? Early startup return on investment. So we know what is return on investment, just to understand these things, return on investment. So when customer is investing in something, they are definitely looking for return. So in Agile, we develop the product. We launch the first version early, and so that the return on investment can be started. So it's a paradigm shift from a plan driven to value driven. When we say plan driven, What do you mean by plan driven?
You just create a big plan, you know, and then you try to meet those milestones and the goals as you progress through the entire project.
Yes.
So your Bible is the, you know, the entire big plan which you have created based on the initial assessment of your risk and requirements and whatever.
Yes. So we are following the plan instead of value. Moreover, Agile is based on empirical process and traditional project management is based upon maybe defined process. Like CMMI level 5 organization, they define some processes, we call them defined process, but Agile is based on empirical process. I found a very good example of task-driven approach or defined process and empirical process. Say, I was standing at the traffic signal and there was a traffic light and above the traffic light there was street light pole. So that street light pole was there because of the defined process. That means they have defined the process, like after every 80 feet there need to be a straight line. So when you have a traffic signal at the 75 feet, so you just put street light just above the traffic signal. Here is my traffic signal, this is my street light. So defined process, the contractor has done as per the defined specification from the MCT or PWD and he got the payment. But where is the value? At that point, traffic signal has more value, so that should be up. Right? So, moreover, in Agile, when we say we will be launching application early, so we will be launching based on these matrices. So 45% features of the products are never used, 19% are rarely used, and 16% sometimes used. So you can see the 80-20 rule. So most of the time, you can say 80% of the time we use 20% features of a product. So as when I bought my car 4 years ago, so he gave me demo, like this is tilt steering, you can just move it down. So that was the first and last time it went down. After that, I have never used it. But companies are charging for that feature. Right? So features are there. We have air conditioner in our box. I don't know. I don't keep chocolate in that glove box. I just keep my registration and another paper, but still there is air conditioner. Okay. Right. So so the value-driven Agile approach switches the whole mindset. It assumes from the start whatever requirement exists upfront are not fixed and they will change. Clear? So any further discussion we want on this? So Agile planning. No, come to the planning part. So how it is different from traditional project planning? Any thought on this?
In case of traditional project planning, you do the whole planning in advance.
Mm-hmm.
So you know in advance what you have to create or what need to be developed. But in case of Agile planning, the planning is incremental. So one part of the project you develop, then thereafter you plan for another part of the process. So the planning is incremental.
Okay.
In traditional development, planning is one task.
Mm-hmm.
And in Agile, it's done in different levels, like
different levels.
Sprint planning, project planning, release planning, sprint planning, and daily planning.
Yes, very, very much.
Planning. So more value in planning in Agile.
Yes. So the very first part is no upfront detailed planning. So we plan, but we don't plan like till the end, just like our like car case. So we are not planning. So we are just planning till the visibility. Right. And next, planning at different level. So we are not, we are just planning for first the high level, and then we are going deep into the detailed level. Minimum documentation. So sometimes people say the Agile has no documentation. So what kind of documentation we can have in Agile?
Business case.
User stories, acceptance criteria, definition of done, program specifications, e-specs, like we do in sprints. For the release, we prepare program specification documents, like what my module is going to do for this sprint.
Okay.
I think that user guides are, I've seen something important, even though in agile setups, user guides are something which are prepared to enable the user to use the product and given insights.
The user guide sometimes considered as deliverable.
Yeah. It's based on customer requirement.
Yes.
If customer needs that,
so
it will be deliverable.
You can go, important go away, like you cannot do any project without documentation. When we do project in Agile without documentation, what I've seen in my experience is that user guide is one is considered as a part of a minimal documentation in Agile, because you do not have detailed requirements.
Yeah.
So there is a way for customer to actually have a look at how the system really works and all. So user guide is something which I have seen in a, as a part of the minimal documentation.
Yeah, moreover, user guide is considered as a deliverable along with the project executable.
Right.
The customer is more happy seeing the software working.
Right.
And then the end user has software working as well as the documentation. So we don't document anything detailed prior to the development.
Not exactly, like when the software is developed, the user doesn't expect give me a project plan also, give me a specification of the software as well, but they will definitely tell me how the software will work.
Yes.
So the user guide is kind of something that mandatorily goes out, whether
yeah,
it is
that
Agile
that
or
as deliverable parts. So
yeah.
We are delivering, so that is definition of done. Sometimes we can put this documentation in the definition of done also. Like, so what we will do, we will do the development, check in everything, do the integration, run the integration test cases, and then if there is any change in that our architecture, and we have maintained that minimum document for that, so we can write a task, okay, update that document also. Right? Since if we are, sometimes we maintain in the larger project or big architect, so we maintain one design document, and we keep on updating document, and Updation in that document is part of your definition of done. Sometimes, like we have a build document. So what are all changes we have made in our system for this particular user story. So updating that build document is also part of definition of done. So it all depends. So what all included in the definition of done should be there. Right? So Agile planning is based on collaboration and not on approval. So it's not something like that we discuss something with the customer initially and then take the sign off and then we will follow that plan. So it is collaborative. Right?
One more question on the previous point. Is there any specific standards that are set by Scrum lines or any organization? These are the minimum set of documentation that should happen.
No, there is no name of document like you need to prepare this document.
Okay.
The only standard that has been set by Scrum and Agile practitioner or expert, so that is the user story, like definition of done, as you said, acceptance criteria, how you specify the acceptance criteria, that may change. Sometime in one of our projects, they have acceptance criteria as well as they have some mock-ups.
Okay. They are
right.
Definitely a part.
So when you click on the, like we are using TFS or any, you can use any tool for the user stories. So when you click on that particular acceptance criteria, it will give you one mockup. So this mockup should look like this. So this kind of documentation can be there. But so that was just the user interface.
Mm-hmm.
So we cannot use that, or there was not document, it was just working. You can click and you can play with that user interface. So that can be part of that your documentation. But you because why do we need document? First of all, we need to focus on like why we need document. Document we require for ourselves, so that normally we say okay, document this thing so that any new person joining into the team, so he should be able to learn the thing. Next use of document is to give it to the customer and take the approval. But here we are saying we are not taking the approval on the document, we are taking approval on the working software itself. If customer says this functionality is working fine, then we don't need any other certificate or any other contract on that. But the first part, user story are the main document as well as the agile practices. If we train the newly inducted team member on agile practices and then show him these are our product backlog user stories and you need to work on these user story from next week, so he should be good.
I think normally in certain cases why do we typically go with say documentation is like you have a concept of sign offs, right? So like you document the requirements and to ensure that there's a clear visibility between what client expects to start off and what you're going to build.
Mm-hmm.
So you document that requirements crystal clear and put it in front of client, get it signed off, and then you work on it. So later on, client, you know, there is a less flexibility for client to say, no, I didn't expect this thing. I was expecting something else. That is when actually sometimes documentation also comes into picture.
Yeah.
So when we talk about hybrid agile, so I think that flexibility needs to be there based on what kind of client you're working with.
Yeah, it depends upon
The relationship, the maturity of the relationship you have with the client, you know, the comfort you have with the client.
Getting everything as in the requirement document sometimes is not possible. That's why we follow agile. But some other document like contract. So normally, just like in agile contracting, it's a separate topic.
Yes.
But it says we should show to the customer like we will deploy say 5 team member. This is our billing rate, and within first 8 weeks, we will be delivering this much functionality, these user story, high priority, high usable user story, those 20%. And sometimes we just quantify the value also. So that if you start using the functionality delivered by us in 8 weeks, you should be able to save $5,000 per week, something like that, depending upon the usability. So in that case, we have given customer and software early, as well as we are quantifying that you should be able to save this much amount of dollar value. So in that case, sometimes the customer, they will say, okay, for 8 weeks, 5% team member, $40 per hour, I will spend this much dollar value and I will save this much of dollar value per week. And that dollar value of like return on investment, that will be increasing exponentially as soon as we are integrating more features into the system. So normally we convince by giving these kind of statistics to the customer, like let's follow agile, just wait, just give us 8 weeks. If we are good, you will know that in 8 weeks, and if we are bad, then even then you will know, okay, these guys are not good, so I can go somewhere else. Instead of just letting us the complete requirement and then spending 6 months and then say, okay, you guys are not good, I'm going somewhere else. Right? So, early failure.
Nice.
I'd like to share a perspective around this is just what we use. I have learned over a period of time, so I try to do that. So, in terms of planning specifically, so we need to understand two types of documents. One is which are deliverable as what Harpreet said, very rightly. Forget about your deliverable. But in order to plan, bare minimum so that you can get to your end product vision, I personally believe 4 things matter. You need to have your vision that what you exactly want to achieve as part of this project program whatsoever. Then you need to have a roadmap in order to reach that. For that roadmap, you will have certain epics which will take you to that roadmap. And then for those epics, you will have some stories in order to fulfill those epics. Now the only thing which most of the times I see people miss out is 2 words called incremental and iterative. What people think is, if I start my project, I need to have my... So your vision and roadmap should be there at the start of your project, but not all the epics.
Yes.
That is something you have to incrementally, iteratively build upon. epics and stories is something which you have to do it iteratively and incrementally. Rest, all these two things probably you have to fix it at the start of the project in terms of sign off from your project sponsor that this is what your vision is. You can change your vision probably, but you can change some feature stories to that vision.
Yes,
yes
please.
What are
the
requirements asked about? Like in some of the organization, I feel that we do have a project sign off and charter. But in comparison to Agile, what we do, whatever he has said, I really appreciate that. That is the way we follow. Like we say that this is a user stories and it will be iteratively coming.
Yes.
So we just provide the link of that thing in the or the details.
Yes, yes. Basically, even that user story need not to be that refined. We can just talk in terms of epics or like big functionality, just like or roughly at the module level itself.
So we can say, okay, this is full module, like this function, this functionality will be integrated with the accounting, invoicing. So we can just use these terms, right?
So, when we
are
on this topic, I'm not sure it's a tangential topic. Like, especially when you have a fixed cost kind of thing in a scenario, you know, wherein you define the scope, you try to close the scope in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you do maybe the planning on the contract?
Yeah, that's what I said. Like even in the fixed contract, so if client is saying, okay, give me the cost. So what we do for that, the first we try to convince customer on the statistic that I just gave you. Okay, you have this requirement, so we will take 8 weeks, first 8 weeks for the first working software, and then every 4 week or depending on our sprint site, we will be delivering you the working software. And this will be the cost for each week that you will be spending. And after 8 weeks, you will start earning this much dollar value. So, and if in that case, customer feels like, okay, my project will go for 6 months or a year, then he can do the calculation himself. Okay, although I'm spending this much dollar value, but at the same time, I'm saving some value. So that is better than these guys giving me a working software 6 months down the line, and for the 6 months, I won't have any return on investment. So this kind of negotiation are more important. But if, so that, I won't recommend like to analyze each and every requirement and then come up with the exact costing and estimation and then start the like development. So I have one example like where the things have been done like that. So they split the entire project into two parts. So one was on the time and material basis. So they say for 1 month, we will be doing all the analysis. So we will be sending a couple of developer for the requirement analysis to on site. So we will charge you for that. And after 2 months, we will give you a ballpark figure or maybe not accurate but budget and the scope and plan everything, and then after that you can decide like whether you want to go the agile way that we are suggesting or you would prefer the traditional way. So that definitely for that purpose definitely we need to split our project into two parts, right? So that because unless we know all the requirements, we cannot calculate the cost and we cannot calculate the risk or schedule and everything.
So all this discussion should be like during contract phase? Right?
Yes.
Before you start working on the
project. Once you got the project, like even once the project is charter is there and you even customer got the approval, like they need to start this project and they have identified the vendor. Right? So after that, these kind of discussion can happen.
So generally, like sometimes during vendor identification only, like they decide that I am going to do this project in a fixed price model, T&M model. So I think, so is this possible that after my company has got that project from any customer, so they have something in mind that okay, I am going to work with this company in fixed price model. So is this possible that I reconvince the customer? No, let's try to.
Yes, yes, it happened a lot of time where because. Once there is the customer is out with a project, so there are a lot of vendors. So customer will choose a vendor with minimum cost, with most experience, with better domain knowledge. So they will have their own parameter like how you understand their requirement, how you present your case, how strong you are technically. So that those things are there to fetch the project. But what Agile says is delivering value to the customer. So even if we have like agreed on the fixed bid or everything, even then we can initiate the discussion. Okay, this is fixed bid. Fixed bid means all these requirements, these are fixed. So you won't change, right? So is it clear you won't change all the requirement for next 2 years or next one year? And if we educate customer on these things, then definitely there are changes.
So even in the very new defined initial set of requirements, in the contract itself, you should need to have a very good strong clause. Like I've been working in the mix of the project. If you have a very strong clause of change control process, right, where you give the flexibility to the client of swapping, you close on the initial scope. You have a scope matrix. Based on that, you will do the big bang planning. You can do the planning. You can say these phases, the roadmap can come up. But if you have that very strong change control process in place, then also that will give you customers a lot of flexibility on swapping the.
But change control, there is always a conflict. Customer says this is common sense. We says this is change request. So it's a most of the time it's a conflict. Like customer will say okay. This is requirement A, B, C, and then D1 requirement should be there automatically. Right? B says you didn't tell us there is a such requirement. So this is a change request. So when we say agile is just to keep safe that sprint requirement and rest everything they can change. Right? So this is the very first step of planning, business justification. So if my organization, they want to start a project, they should have some business justification. Why do we need to start a project? Right? This is what we say business justification. Some business case should be there, and some business case should save some cost. So why do we execute project? Any thought? Why do company execute projects?
For business value addition.
For business value, and can you be more specific?
So anything that enhances their current process and increases their return on investment, current investment, or even their further customer satisfaction and increase in business.
Yes, basically we are talking about operational efficiency. So there is one hospital, so they are not into IT, but still they need IT project. Why? They want to just automate the process and to have the operational efficiency and save some cost.
There could be many other reasons. Market share.
New launch of a product. New contract.
See, even saving the existence of the company.
Yes. Yeah. So, estimation of project value. So we know what is PV, present value, IRR, ROI. So these are the very complex topic on the basis of which we identify which project we should go for. So it's not just there is some number, so the complexity is calculating these numbers. To understanding these numbers are simple, but to calculate these numbers are very complex. Project charter. So this is also come with the initial planning. So charter just signify this project exists. And there is one sponsor, there is one person in this world who is ready to pay money for this project. So that's what the intent of project charter. So at the same time, stakeholders. So what is stakeholder?
Everybody who is involved in the project, who will be affected with the project, with the progress of the project, with the success of the project.
If there is construction going on in my home and I just put a pile of sand on my neighbor's door, so is he a stakeholder?
Yes. Negative stakeholder.
Negative. Okay. So stakeholders could be internal and external. So we will pick. So how much time I have? 10 minutes?
15
okay.
Minutes.
Okay. So what we can do here is, we can just, instead of browsing these slides, so we can just discuss a case. Right? So, what should be there and what should not be there. So let's take a fictitious company, ABC International, and they are talking about a project to be developed for themselves. Right? And so what should be the very first step? I am a CEO of the company, and how should I know like which project I should start?
This should be aligned with the company strategy. Like,
yeah, there should be some vision, right? So very first thing is the top management, so they should work on a vision. Like when Apple, they started iPhone development, so they started one project Purple 2. So that was nothing but the like having a touchscreen functionality on a monitor. And then once that functionality was ready, the vision changed. They said, okay, monitor is fine, but let's have this functionality into a phone. So they created a vision, okay, our vision is to create a smartest phone in the market. And they, based on that vision, they created the roadmap and everything, so that we will discuss. So the very first level of planning is, what is project vision? Vision is broadcast picture that one can paint of the future. Like how I see my product in the future is vision. What, who, why, when. What is my vision? What is the product I am talking about? Who all will be the users or the person affected by this product? When? Constraint and assumption. So vision just gives you a focus. So when we study, so we do engineering. So our vision is to get place in one company or do some startup and everything. So these are our visions. So that's why I say if you don't know where you are going, that's where you will end up. So you should be focused. Next, product roadmap. Roadmap, you can say, are the steps to achieve that vision. Like for in case of iPhone, we have they say okay, we will have first version 2.0 that will have basic minimum set of features, and then version 3.0 we will have some enhanced features. So this kind of basically we are doing the versioning here, right? First version, second version, and so that we can achieve to our vision. So high level themes for the next few releases: show progress towards strategy, determine and communicate when releases are needed. So there are two things. Most of the products, we come across two terms, releases and versions. Right? In actual scenario, when we talk about the big product, we talk about okay, version 1, version 2, version 3, and these are releases. So are you clear, like are they related, like or what are they?
Yes.
Right, because one version can have multiple releases, right? So sometimes it's all depend upon the how soon we are going into the production. Sometimes we have one release 2, and then both the releases are making version 1. Sometimes we have just release 1 and that is going into the production. And one release can have multiple sprints. So product roadmap is the second level. Focus on the business value derived from the releases, value-based prioritization. Product roadmap is owned and driven by product owner. So, once the CEO of the company, they have vision, so next step will be the identifying the roadmap.
You
and
see, sorry. You just mentioned that a given version can have multiple releases, right?
Yes.
So now, when for example, then say any new version is launched into the market, so when we go for a, so basically internally you mean to say there are multiple code deployments that happen to production, but when we actually launch or publicize this thing in the market,
uh-huh.
it's like a couple of releases that have happened and then we... Uh-huh. Like,
yeah. Yes. So the reason for that is there is concept of minimum marketable feature, right? You can launch a product unless you have those set of minimum features which are must for a product. For example, a cell phone has some basic features calling, messaging, imaging, camera, and everything, right? So we cannot launch a phone without this feature. But sometimes, like in the software development, what we do, we identify some set of features like which are minimally required for this product to be used by the end user. So what we do, we just say for, we spend a couple of sprints or 2-3 sprints and then call it a release one. And release one is there with the client in the beta environment itself. In the meantime, we are working on the release two. So when we have these release two, we integrated these two, and then there is some version one deadline. So versions or the roadmap could be time driven as well as the value driven. Sometimes we say, okay, second quarter of 2017, we will be launching the next version of our software. Right. So in that case, there could be multiple releases. We can just pile up those releases into the beta. They do the testing, because it's not, when we say, it's easy to say, okay, we develop and everything and put it into the production. But most of the time, the releases are time-based. So on that particular time, till that particular time, the companies, they just keep on beta testing, keep on inviting more stakeholders, more customers, giving demonstration and everything. So once they have those two releases, which we assume are good enough to fulfill condition of minimum marketable feature, we can launch the version. So first version is last, subsequent version we can launch. Subsequent releases we can just integrate into the production. It's a matter of just the first release to the end user, right? So as soon as we identify the roadmap and then we identify person called product owner. So as soon as this product owner is identified, product owner start writing a list of requirement that we call, product. So next level of planning. Release plan. So what is there in release planning?
These are the set of the features of the functionality we will be releasing in this.
Yes.
That is something.
It is more based on MVP, most viable product, or
yes,
either on budget, most incremental proposition.
Are you clear on this?
I'm clear on that any new version can have multiple releases.
Yes.
Okay. And any release plan can have multiple iterations of the specs.
Exactly.
So it actually decides the product owner what kind of functionality he was looking for this in the release.
Yes.
Which could be a 3-4, 3-month, 4-month, 5-month, whatever.
Yes. So release planning is a projection, it's not the commitment.
Right.
So that is very important.
So it's actually commitment.
No, depending upon the, as you say, minimum viable feature. So till that point, it is a commitment. But once we have those minimum viable feature or minimum marketable feature into the market, then we can just increment any, like independently, like usable feature into the production. Even if it is a very small feature. So release plan comprises of release theme, release content, business value statement, and release timeline.
So there is no DOD at release level, right? If it's not done.
At this point?
At release level, is there in DOD? Like we have DOD at the rest of the level. So we put some, if it's not
at
done.
At the release level, we can say like if our release is done or not. For the user story, we have some. So in the user story, there are two parts: definition of done,
right,
and acceptance criteria. Acceptance criteria is business oriented. Acceptance criteria will be checked by product owner. But
right,
definition of done is team's definition.
Right.
So you can say, in other words, definition of done is task oriented, and acceptance criteria is value oriented.
What he is asking is that do we define the definition of done at the release plan?
Not really. I mean, no. You can have definition of done of an iteration maximum, that's all.
But within the sprint. Sometimes I think about it, if you are not really clear about the, what kind of, the, because to have a rhythm, you have a release plan for the 4 months, 6 months, 3 months, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So you know the, your velocity or whatever, your capacity, whatever. So, so you should have that, these kind of stories I can do, I can release. This is, I have the capacity. So that's why I should be very clear about the, these particular number of stories I should be selecting for this release. And this should be the, why I'm asking, saying this, because I can reach that target based upon the acceptance criteria and definition of target. That's a confusion. Sometimes I get confused. I mean, if, not in the detail level, but I should be very clear about that, what actually the customer is asking for, if he is asking for this particular user story to be released.
No, that the very first thing is, it all depends on the prioritization that is set by the customer. So that is very, very important, since in the figure that we see, only those 20% of user story we are just taking care. So if we have that prioritization in this place, then I think there should not be any issue. So that is only the definition of time. Depending upon our velocity, depending on our capacity, we are selecting only those top user story from the product backlog and doing the development. So
shall,
yes.
Shall I add something?
Yes, yes.
On when we develop product, the product have different phases. So when he's talking about release plan, we are actually into the planning phase only. We have not gone into the implementation phase. When you expect DoD, DoD is expected before the implementation starts. So we are in a phase of planning that how we are planning for the project with milestone and product backlog being ready. But this also on this level, product backlogs will not be having a total lower level of teeny story. It can be in a form of epic, a very big things. And then
understood. I'm clear about it. But what happens, if I'm discussing something that this is the epic or this is the release plan I have got, this is functionality I want to see. So if the customer says that this is a set of functionality, I want to see the release plan. Otherwise, there is no use of it.
True.
Because it will be, you know, you set it aside, I will not be able to market it. Okay, fine. You don't have any definition ready at that time. So you select 20 stories, which actually accumulates to 100 points, story points. But as soon as you see your capacity or velocity, you see that you are not able to say, release it. Then you say, no, these much, instead of 20 stories, I'll be selecting only 15 stories. Because this is my velocity. What do you do at that time? That's a confusion I'm saying.
Okay.
I am very clear about that you don't have a definition of done acceptance criteria at the release planning. But you should have some idea that this is something I can release. But otherwise, it's all fake.
No,
it's
all
fake.
Can I share?
Sure.
Yes, yes, yeah.
So there are two things, setting a goal and achieving that goal. So
right.
At the planning time, you can only set the goal. But you can't be sure that you will be able to achieve that goal. So let's not confuse between these two things. Definition of done is in order to measure whether you are able to achieve that goal or not. Setting the goal is only at the planning level, that I will on a high level give these many features to you by this time what we agreed to. Now as we go through each iteration, there is a transparency that what level of goal we are able to achieve, and that's where we respond to the change.
Moreover, when we talk about release planning, it's not specific, okay, we will have this release.
Exactly.
And there is no lead time after the development is finished. So there are two ways, one is feature driven, one is the time driven. So normally customer set their own timeline, like after the development team release everything to the customer or to the business people, they take some time before actually releasing that into the market. So we have that kind of thing. So normally when we do the release planning, so it goes one or two iteration extra. It's my real time scenario.
So you can change your time period for this release plan.
Yes.
From
yes.
3 months to 4 months.
Yes.
Or whatever.
Yes.
You
can change
based on customer collaboration.
Yes.
Basically.
We can change it, but the thing is, the customer is targeting the end user on that specific date. Even if we have completed it, so it all depends upon the communication between the customer. Yes, yes.
So customer has to take a call either to release it with X number of story points,
yes,
that I have today.
Yes.
Or if the remaining of the story points are very critical, if this needs to be delayed or not.
Yeah.
And anyways, see, the customer
normally,
is anyways...
Normally we extend.
With every sprint, customer is looking forward to that. Okay, in every this there are like six sprint planned for my release. So first sprint I got this, second sprint I got this, third sprint I got this. By third sprint he'll know that within by six sprint if I'll get completely or not. He won't wait for till fifth sprint that I'll that. Okay, if he is progressing at the rate of 15 stories per...
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, we, the customer has liberty on that part.
Exactly.
So that's why we are giving customer liberty to change some of the requirement. Yes. Yes. Anything else? Like, we... most of the things, like, we have covered beforehand. So we are in the release planning. So any further discussion on this? Because this was a very good topic. Most of the time, since it is conflicting with two parts, we are saying like we are releasing everything on that specific date for once, and at the same time we are saying like we are not allowing customer to add more change into the system. So now we can just conclude in this scenario in this way. Say we have a release plan on this particular date. These are the features. We are into the sprint one, so we cannot stop customer from adding new features into the next sprint. Like if customer add new features, so that customer will add, so that will change the release plan, that particular product, and that may result adding maybe one or two sprint into the release plan. So that when we say release plan and minimum viable features or minimal marketable product into the market, so the customer should have that buffer after that, the completion of that release, right? So you understand this, what I'm saying?
Theoretically, बहुत अच्छा लगता
है, but actually होता है ये एक sprint extra normally होती है customer के लिए.
I'm struggling with that, that's what I'm saying.
Okay.
तो नहीं date तो यही है, चार चीजें और.
नहीं date ना अगर date customer fix कर रहा है तो that is not agile.
MVP has to be very clearly defined.
अगर customer is fixing that date of the release.
He's actually giving the buffer he has got for himself.
But most of the time there is delay because we cannot stop customer from adding feature into the subsequent sprints. In the current sprint we can keep it safe, but most of the time they add.
So the perspective I would like to call out here is
this is what we are concluding. So we should be quick.
So the whole point I have is what you just rightly said. I am adding something, I should be willing to take out something.
Yes.
And if it was so important, then something has to be leased. As you say, 20-80%, 80-20 rule has to always apply. You can't say everything is next to must. Fair enough. That's all I have to say.
So this is the conclusion of this session. So I was like, I came here to conclude something else, but I think...
that's being agile.
That's adaptive.
That's adaptive.
Okay, thank you for your comment.